Phil, we've done about testicular cancer, the videos you've seen them, so let's look about some of the problems afterwards. We're here today with Nick O'Hara Smith and a load of survivors talking about testosterone depression and other problems you might face.
Tell me what life was about before you got testicular cancer.
I would say my life was good. Can't think of anything that was particularly nasty about it, so I was enjoying life.
He had just had the surgery to remove the testicle just before I met him.
That was lovely. Even with even though we were in loads and loads of debt and we'd had a van repossessed, we still had a wonderful holiday every year. You know, four like beautiful children. It was just really, really, really happy.
I used to ride trucks all up and down the country. And I used to be in the army for 12 years. Life was fine. Everything was happy.
I felt, because she's quite ill as well, you know, and has been for about 3 years now with her own condition.
So he basically took care of me for a very long time until I kind of got myself back on track, which took a very long time.
Where I was the one that was like, it's okay then. We'd be okay, we'll get through this, we'll be fine, I'll get you through this, and you know, that kind of thing.
That I've had my journey with my thing. I have a condition called fibromyalgia.
Life before I got testicular cancer was pretty good.
Very good. I'd been married for about 7 or 8 years before I had cancer.
At the time I was single, living at home with my mum and dad, brother and sister.
Before I got cancer, I probably worked very hard, I trained very hard, and I partied very hard. And that was really my life.
Pretty normal in my eyes. Steady job, girlfriend, family. Would have went to the gym quite a bit.
When you were at the gym?
Yeah.
Did you encounter steroid use?
Yeah.
By others?
Yeah.
Even yourself?
Yeah.
You used it
yourself? Yeah.
Okay.
It caused sexual problems, believe it or not, which I've never really spoke about. The testicle that they removed was the smaller. It never came back properly after steroid use. It shrank them both at the time.
I was pretty ignorant, really, being a typical 25-year-old, sort of ignorant to a lot of stuff going on in the world and just enjoying the day to day.
I haven't really been the healthiest of people. I was born 3 months premature with various issues to do with that, including hydrocephalus and something called Perthes disease, which is bone softening of the hip bones. I came through that basically until I was about 12, 13, and up to after then I was relatively healthy. And everything was fine.
Relationships?
No relationships, no.
Okay.
No.
I was single. It was like, it was a big ball, really. The world was a stage. I was a DJ, so I travelled around a lot. UK DJ of the year 1993, UK DJ of the year 1995, and also the same in 97.
My name is Tracy Thomas, and I'm a clinical nurse specialist for urological cancers. A Clatterbridge Cancer Centre on the rural Merseyside.
Well, my name's Dan, Dan Bill, two first names.
Now you haven't had testicular cancer, have you?
No.
Okay.
Well, I've got low testosterone, right. So I'm well below where I should be for a 23-year-old. There's two sort of companion reasons why it might be, although I've never been given a definitive reason of what it is. The first one is that I was born with only one testicle.
I think we've got to empower the patient, otherwise the patient loses control.
I suppose really I didn't have any expectations, but I wondered, would I be on my own with the post-impact of cancer? How was it going to impact my ability to father children?
I wasn't really sure what to expect, whether that would be it, or what would happen, or whether he'd have to have further treatment.
Some days I thought it'd just sort of carry on as it was before, because obviously everything's been taken away. But other times you sort of think, well, I'm missing something that I should have. Yeah, because I went straight back to work.
Yeah, I did, yeah. Even though his GP said no, and I said no, and his consultant at Birmingham said no.
I didn't feel full as a man. I then went into depression myself.
Definitely. I remember going to work with him one day, and Dean works in a truck, and somebody had cut him up, and he literally jumped out of the cab to go and have a go at them.
They asked me up at the hospital, they said, are you okay? And I said, well, I'm a bit tired and drained. And they said, well, are you able to go out and cut the grass? Do the sort of normal thing, start to do the normal things. And I said, well, I've been back to work the last 6 weeks. And they went, no, that's going to stop now.
Well, this is the thing. Everybody kind of said to me, you know what, now you're through the other side. And yeah, I know what you mean. Yeah, good. But no, I'm not. I don't think I really agree with you there, pal. You know,
we just thought, you know, chemo is over. It'll take him a while to get back to himself.
I was told that I was lucky. It was stage one. It was very early, and I should plan as normal, and life should go on as normal.
And then essentially, it was a case of just getting back to work, and then we'd carry on as normal.
I think I expected to get back to normal, whatever normal was.
I suppose I thought things would settle down and things would come together naturally.
Well, to be honest, that was the start of the fatigue. To my best knowledge, that was the start of it. Obviously, the 2 weeks was expected. You know, I knew I would be tired, but I was led to believe that with the removal of one testicle, I would be back to normal.
Mm-hmm.
With, you know, one would do the job of the other. Unfortunately, it didn't happen like that for me.
I honestly expected it as soon as I'd come out the hospital for treatment just to bang straight back to normal, but my head was a mess. It was absolutely terrible.
I was told basically you have a series of follow-ups, scans, x-rays, blood tests, every 3 months, 6 months, until you get in, and then they keep following you for 10 years, and sort of keep an eye on things and see how it goes, basically.
That was before I had the operation.
Me personally, I think we should be educating boys younger and making men more aware and trying to change the culture. A lot of men will carry on with things and not do anything about it.
Got into the competitive cycling when I was about 13. And by this point in my life, I'd already had kind of two OCDs, one of which was washing of hands. I used to wash my hands, they were red raw when I was little. So the cycling was just a platform for another one, really. So a big one of that was diet. And essentially, I cut all fats out of my diet. About 15, by this point, I was now pretty full-blown anorexic. And I pretty much stayed that way all the way through my teenage years.
But it's been really hard to find the me that was pre-cancer.
I kind of felt a bit like on the outside, sort of looking and not really sure what to do at times.
It was making me very paranoid, very depressed, and just very isolated from everything that I knew and understood. And then I reached out to a number of people, you being one of which, online, and you know, and things started to make a little bit more sense. I would say to a certain extent, the things that I'm going through now are a root cause of denial. So I've kind of parked up the whole, yeah, I know I've had cancer and all of that stuff, but actually the way it's had an impact on me has been parked up and festering away, waiting to be opened up.
No, that was, it's really weird. It was so weird. I remember being really, really angry with the cancer specifically, not just cancer, but that cancer, because of what it'd done to us.
The doctor signed me off.
the hospital signed me off for a couple of weeks. I went back to see the doctor. He signed me off. That's when I went on the antidepressants. I've seen counsellors. I've seen my doctor so many times. Somebody mentioned get your testosterone checked because that will help. He phoned me back. He said, "Yeah, it's within range. It's 7.3." Which I found out later, for my age, it was 7 to 28. I was very different. I didn't feel like I was the strong one anymore. There were just moments where I just felt, I'm not keeping it together here. I'm snapping for no reason.
Because my mind wanted me to say, no, everything's fine. You're not going to have another challenge this big, this soon. You know, and it was just like, no, this can't be happening.
You know, I'm very emotional, very sensitive. It just, I didn't feel, my balance was kind of funny. I had issues with my balance. I had issues with, still have issues with my balance. My memory is fuzzy. I don't have a great memory.
Because he was getting to the point where he was, you know, getting really irritable and kind of snappy and quite down. I remember coming out of the appointment and just thinking, this doesn't really end.
I had my moments of doubt. You know, oh, look at him over there, he's, you know, strong and he's got two testicles.
Darren just got through it. And it's only now that things are starting to trickle in, and, you know, which makes sense because that's pretty much how my journey came about, yes, as well. Lots of denial, getting through it. Yeah, everything's fine. I'm fine. Yeah, it's going to be okay.
Something was shifting. Because Elaine was, suddenly an influx of information was coming from Elaine.
People around me were sort of saying, come on, you're over this now. Let's move on. And I wasn't. And within a couple of months, when my bloods got back to their full levels, I should feel back to normal, which, when that didn't happen, is when I started to look for help and look for support from elsewhere, because I wasn't getting any answers from my doctors. Well, for starters, I felt very depressed. I wasn't sleeping right. I was waking up in the middle of the night with extreme palpitations in my chest. The doctors eventually gave me tablets for depression. Yeah, they helped me sleep, but I didn't get any better.
I returned to my job as an assistant manager at McDonald's, hoping to make manager. And then it just started to, the wheels started to fall off, if you like. I found that at work, I was a different animal. I found that I didn't have the energy at all to go about the business like I would have done before cancer, only several months previous. Mental confusion, depression. The doctor wanted me to go to a psychiatrist.
As time went on, I noticed my energy levels were dropping. Then all of a sudden, I was very emotional. I was having anxiety attacks. I was thinking, oh, I shouldn't be here. By that time, I'd met Corin, my fiance, and okay, our children. And she knew I wasn't feeling too well about myself. Mood swings were gradually getting worse. I started having dark thoughts as well.
I suppose I did go back to my old way of life. I finished my chemotherapy on the Wednesday. I started back at full-time work on the Monday. I went straight back into running again. And I did quite a bit of partying again. After chemotherapy, I did my first half marathon 2 months later. It continued probably right up from June until maybe Christmas. I started feeling very, very tired. When my hair grew back, I've always had a beard, so my hair grew back, wasn't a ginger beard, it was a completely black beard. I think about December time, it started getting very, very thin. So I decided to shave it off, and when I shaved it off, it didn't grow back.
Well, I had depression for 6-7 years, prior to the cancer, but from the cancer until now, I've been through, I think I'm on third type of tablet now. I wasn't sleeping at night.
I'd be going to work, I'd have a good day going to work. Oh, this is fantastic. I feel great, life's back to normal. And then it sounds terrible, but the next day I get to work and I feel like driving my car into the wall. Pull over in my car some days and just burst into tears. Just at a loss, just total helplessness, because you can't understand why it's happening. I found the best therapy is my job. It didn't feel like it was depressed. I'd get ready for work some days, and it almost felt like I'd constantly got the flu. The whole time you're constantly forgetting things and having no real sharpness of thought, or my cognitive ability just sort of scrambled.
I became a lot more honest with myself. I didn't realise how reliant I would become on the testosterone. That was nasty. I had the second surgery when they fully removed the testicle. And I found out subsequently that they were supposed to give me an injection, actually at the end of it, to boost my testosterone before my first follow-up, which was, I think, 3 weeks afterwards. But they forgot to do it. Before the end of the 3 weeks, I was pretty much suicidal.
Crikey. It never got better, it just got worse. Year after year. I could never put my finger on it. Could never put my finger on how I felt. You know, and I hid it from so many people for so long. You want them to talk to you as Mark, not as Mark with cancer. But then I decided that I needed a persona. My stage name was Porky, but I wasn't Porky or Mark or... Yeah, I thought I'd died the day they took the testicle out. I put a lot of weight on with the chemo drugs. So I decided to get the Robbie Williams suit. I put the face paint on and I called myself Blobby Williams.
Once you've had the treatment, that's where the hard part begins. That's the challenge. And then you get the patients who can't return to work, can't get back to their normal again, can't take the kids out for a walk in the park. Motivation, fatigue, depression, that can start.
By the time I was 20, I'd pretty much got out of it. I was still cycling very heavily, still competing. Most of the races, most of the season, most of the time when I was riding, I just didn't feel particularly good. And life up to this point had been pretty depressed. It felt like I was in a box. I'd done a lot of, I'd done my own sort of research on the internet, and I'd kind of thought to myself, hold on a second, I'm a 23-year-old guy here, and not once really grown up through my late teenage years had I really kind of thought that much about women and that sort of thing. I'd never had that kind of switch on point that, you know, adolescent guys do, where, you know, sex is on the mind all the time, and, you know, I looked at people around me and, you know, that's what they were doing.
I was very lucky to have met a girl whilst I was out partying and enjoying myself, and she was a lovely girl. She just taught me really that I can be a man, and we had a good few months. I met a wonderful lady called Lisa, who is now my fiance, and she's just the most amazing person I could have ever wished for. We found it hard.
I wouldn't say it was easy. It has been hard at times.
So the doctor decided to put me on to the injection. Somewhere along the line, it got messed up as how many times I should have it. So I had it on the first time. I had the second one after 4 weeks. The third one after 4 weeks. Fifth, sixth, seventh. I noticed I was getting aggressive.
I loved him more than I'd ever loved him. But I don't remember ever thinking, I'm going to leave him because of this.
I did feel I pushed her, though, to a limit.
I wouldn't say threatened, because that's quite a strong word. Maybe challenged.
No, I think it was stronger than that.
You'd have to ask her, really, but my wife had an affair, a long affair, nearly 8 to 12 months. That nearly cost me my marriage. She said I was lacking in the empathy and love department. We both shared responsibility for what had happened.
It was also difficult anyway in regards to money. Right. All that money was tight, so the recession was hitting us. I had a young family. We was both in pretty much low paid jobs. Plus I had testosterone issues as well.
Did you have any dark thoughts? Really dark?
I suppose I was quite anxious in many ways. It was the real strong feeling of being lost. I don't think I was in any way depressed, but I just felt lost.
I would say I went into a pretty bad state of depression then.
Did you ever consider
ending it? Being honest, yeah.
All right. You ever taken any steps towards it? What stopped you?
The sun. Yeah. Couldn't do it on.
No, obviously I was dating and courting people, but I honestly found post-cancer, my interest in that had just dropped off totally. Suddenly you've gone from being an efficient young man to just in pieces. It was always the antidepressant route, and even recently it's been the antidepressant route as well.
I just lashed out at anyone where I'd hit rock bottom. I hadn't seen the endocrinologist. I had seen the endocrinologist, but the effects hadn't started to take effect. And yeah, I was feeling pretty suicidal, to be honest. I was so angry.
I'd phoned you a few times. I spoke to Feli.
What were you saying?
I'd had enough. It was Jesus Christ, you bastard.
1-0, I'd say.
Went to get tested at the doctor's this time last year, basically, May 2012. Eventually, after a long wait for the NHS and a bit of a battle with it as well, got prescribed onto the testosterone gel. You know, because it'd been almost a year since getting diagnosed with the condition to receive the treatment. You know, you are close to, you know, wanting to commit suicide at some point. And I was, you know, and I haven't had a relationship. It wasn't living, it was just existing.
But not many patients know about hormones and what the lack of the male hormone can do to that patient and have on their body, but not just on the patient, but also on the family as well. When people say, oh, it's just hormones, it may be just hormones to them, but if you're the person who's suffering from those side effects, it's a hell of a thing to go through. I think we need to change perceptions of GPs.
Very luckily for me, I have health insurance with my company. I spoke to my germ cell nurse and she said, well, I can get you a referral on the NHS, which she did. And that was about a 6-month waiting list. I then arranged for the private appointment by the end of the week. And the first thing she did was put me on testo gel. Have had an issue. I was looking at myself in the mirror whilst applying this stuff. And for me, it was creating almost a sort of self-doubt. I'm less of a man. Latterly, though, I'm seeing it just part of taking a vitamin pill.
He seems exactly the same person, but he just seems a bit more... He's not so unbalanced.
Talking to Dr. Ahmed, the endocrinologist, she says I'll be on the testo for the rest of my life, and that is not a problem. As long as I know I can get the level right, it will help me with the mental health issues that I've got currently.
Now he's started the testosterone and the counselling.
Most of my t-shirts wouldn't fit me because I'd really bulked out without even trying. I then went for another test. Friday I had the injection. And then the Monday, I think it was, or Monday or Tuesday, I got the results back.
Which were?
49.5. I haven't taken any since. I think it's finally sort of coming out of me now. I'd probably go back on the gel. It's safer.
I think he should, because I wonder if sometimes that's why he's so tired all the time, because he needs it.
I found the video first, and I wanted to watch it, so I did.
I didn't want to watch it. I basically just came home after a day's work, ready to fall asleep, and Elaine had this video ready for me to watch. So just, I think you need to see this for yourself. I was like, oh my God, that's what's wrong with me. I'm 2 weeks into it. And it's, you know what, I just think to myself, I just don't like it. This is something I have to do now for the rest of my life. For the rest of my life.
There's a commitment to be made. You can't break the commitment, otherwise you're going to feel absolutely rubbish.
Just in that alone, in my energy, I couldn't believe the difference. It was immense. It was so important.
Yeah, he doesn't seem as tired. He still does get bouts of tiredness, but nowhere near, like, I mean, he would have just sat on the couch and nodded off instantly. And he's starting to kind of get his mojo back, I suppose.
I spoke with my consultant about getting my testosterone levels checked. They came back and he said they were all right. So I went on for another few months and thought, something's still not right here. So I went to my doctor's, another testosterone coat, and they came back very low. Well, I didn't really want to be taking a medicine. I don't really want to take something unless I have to take it. Improvement wasn't straight away, but slowly and surely, I felt a lot better.
It wasn't, so we're talking 2001, 2002, the end of 2001, going into 2002, this was. And I think it was around 9, so that now will be considered candidate for therapy, wouldn't it, on the new guidelines. 70-year-old men get on fine with that, so why can't you? I accepted that, or just under 4, and they said they wouldn't treat me anyway until it got to less than 3. So I went back to the doctor with this. He says, we can see that there's a distinct pattern here, that it is going down and down and down, and we'll prescribe you just testosterone.
I went to the doctors. I says, I've got all these mood swings. I think it's related to the fact I had testicular cancer previously. It could have something to do with my testosterone levels. Can you help me? He says, I'm going to put you in for counselling instead. I got in touch with Philly and then yourself, and he gave me the encouragement I needed. Got the results back. He first of all didn't want to give me my results back to me, so I told him that they belonged to me. I got in touch with yourself, and you told me I wasn't normal. In the nicest possible way. First time I was trying my testosterone, so I've gone from just merely existing to living.
I never had my testosterone checked before I had my orgiectomy. My testosterone levels were checked again and they had dropped. Last year I ran 9 marathons, and it certainly was in the back of my head, could I have done this without testosterone? Am I cheating? At the minute, I don't take it every day. I have no anxiety. I have no real problems that were in my life before.
Went to the doctor, explained. Energy levels were very low. Found it hard to get out of bed. So it was trying to work out whether it was the tablet, excuse me, or whether it was the hormones. He phoned me then, said could I come down and see him. Went down to see him and he said, your testosterone's low. So we started the test jobs then, every 12 weeks.
I did ask for my testosterone levels to be checked. And for a man of 24 to 26, it was around the 21, 22 range. I was coming up between 11 and 14 every time. I've been told it's more than adequate. When you know it's something that can be fixed or be solved, it can eat at you.
I've taken, I think, 3 injections at 11 week frequency, and there's no obvious dip in my moods or feelings or anything like that. I haven't had a relationship as such. I've had a few close friends. I am a gay guy, yes. Basically, I've been sort of denying it for 35 years.
I think the first time I knew something was really wrong was the 17th of January in 2009. I collapsed and ended up in an ambulance.
What did I tell you?
Classic signs of low testosterone. Go to your doctors and get a test. I asked my... we'll do it fine, but okay. Can't see there's any link with it. I was slightly above the legal limit to be treated for the first test. So we had another test done, another blood test done, and then it came back at 8.4. The doctor told me if I packed in smoking, he'd treat me. March the 12th, 2009 was the last day I ever smoked a cigarette. I'm not sure if I am, but we think I'm one of the first men in the UK to be prescribed Arimidex. I had some problems with my pancreas through the chemo. Yeah, and while I was in there with the endocrinologist one day, last year, he decided to take me off testosterone. You don't need testosterone because you've got one testicle, you're too fat. I went on the slippery slope down. My marriage was breaking down. My life was what I'd been relying on, a hormone to survive every day, to give me a little bit of a get up and go. That had been taken away.
If you can have a small amount of testosterone and it helps the symptoms, that's going to save us, in the long term, a lot of time, a lot of money for the NHS. You'd be looking at bone density. Your bone marrow could be a problem, so you could be anemic. If you're anemic, you may need to have blood transfusions. That can help with your cardiovascular system, so you can have a lot of problems there. Have problems with your renal issues, so there's a lot of issues a low testosterone can lead to, but that's the long-term issues.
Okay, I'm getting on.
Yes.
And I got this dream.
Go on, tell me.
Male hormone health reaches the same kind of prominence as female hormone health is. That's my dream.
Yeah.
Do you share that?
Yes. And I hope it does happen. And I think it will happen.
I better live then.
When Philly Morris asked me to make this film, I was determined to get as much as I could from it. And to do that, I've been speaking, as you've seen, to a number of testicular cancer patients, one who hasn't had testicular cancer, but all of whom have had hormone problems that have affected their life. In America, they've discovered that cancer survivors, male cancer survivors, who live beyond the age of 60, approximately half of them have hormone problems. We want to change that. And we know, with the information we've got, we're not telling lies. We're telling it how it is. We're not trying to knock anybody. And despite all the evidence that you've heard from people saying their doctors said no and so on, we have to understand we are actually at the forefront of what's going on in medicine and the understanding of male hormones. So from here on, we hope to see an increase in understanding, a better treatment, and also a situation that arises where all cancer patients get checked for their hormones, because not to do so will inhibit their recovery and cost the country money. Thank you.
Thank you.